Those people, you know, a person, human personality is composed of his body, of his mind, of his heart, of his soul, of his hidden secrets, and of his internal abilities, spiritual abilities. So there are many aspects which put together, if you put together, they compose the human personality. There are outer aspects and there are inner aspects of human personality. In the same way, in Sharia, all laws and all practices and all Sharia acts, they have in the same way outer aspects and inner aspects. For every act there is a zahir, and for every aspect there is a batin. Externality and internality, outer self and inner self, for each and every act, even for good and pious acts, and even for sins. Quran says, ظَاهِرُ الْإِسْمِ وَبَاطِنُهَا. Even an act of sin has a zahir and it has a batin. It has an external appearance and it has internal and hidden reality. The same way our prayers, our pious acts, our acts of worship, there is a zahir and there is a batin. When we pray, we stand up and we start our praying. So our standing, saying takbir, our standing, our ruku, our sujood, our qiyam, our recitation of Fatiha, recitation of Quranic verses, then our sitting, our qu'ud, then our reading of salat, and then we are doing salam, right and left turning the face, all these acts which we are doing, this is the external act of worship, external act of prayer. This is the whole sum of externality of the prayer. I am not saying the whole sum of prayer. No, I am saying the whole sum of externality of the prayer. Now there is an internality, an inner aspect, internal aspect, hidden aspect of the same prayer. What is that prayer? That is niyyah. Your intention, your motive. You have done all your acts according to the prescription of Sharia. So outer aspects and outer conditions of prayer, of salat, are fulfilled. But one thing you have not performed. What is that? That is your niyyah. You did not make niyyah for salah. Niyyah is not an external act. You did not have intention or motive of praying. But what intention did you have? For example, Kanpur, he saw somebody, a policeman, was coming to arrest him because of some crime, because of some wrong act. When he saw a policeman coming, just to save himself from the policeman, he started, Allahu Akbar. And this Mr. Kanpur is reading Quran. He read the whole Surah Yasin up to Surah An-Nas. He is performing ruku, performing sujood, qu'ud, jalsa. He has done everything. But fearing from the policeman, he may not be arrested. He thinks that he is not a naughty man. He is a pious person. He is praying, worshipping Allah. All acts which he has done are the same as you are doing sincerely in the mosque. No difference as far as the externality is concerned. So whatever he has done, well, tell me now, would his act be accepted in the eyes of Allah as prayer, as salat? Why not? He did takbir tahreema. He placed his hands here. He read Surah Fatiha. He read a surah. He went in ruku. He went in sujood. He read all four rakah. He sat on tashahud, on qada. He did everything. Why his prayer is not accepted? I'm explaining you what is, who is Sufi and what is Tasawwuf or spiritualism. You will understand why I correlated this example with that. When you understand the example, all of a sudden your mind will get open. Why his whole act, he spent 1 hour in 2 nafals. He kept on reading Quranic surahs till policeman went away. This person, Kanpur. Why his salah is not accepted? And another person who finished 2 rakah within 2-3 minutes, his salah is accepted. Why? Tell me. Because he did everything which was visible, which was in Zahir. But the only one single thing which was hidden in Batin, the Niyyah, intention, he didn't adopt that. So only one single reality of Niyyah which was hidden, he missed that and fulfilled all of external requirements. So in spite of fulfilling all external requirements, his prayer is not a prayer. So this is the internal link between Zahir and Batin. The difference between the two, those who fulfill the needs of Zahir, at the same time, for example, somebody is praying or fasting, and he is fasting with this niyyah that people may consider me a very pious man. Remaining external acts are the same. He ate sahari, he did not eat anything, didn't drink anything till sunset, and he had his iftar with you. He fulfilled all external laws and requirements except the niyyah, which was the batin. So would he be rewarded for fasting? No. So one thing which he missed is batin. And all other things which he performed, dozens of other things which he performed, they are zahir. So it means dozens of acts in external existence, zahir, dozens and dozens of acts, they are rejected because of just one act which is hidden. So correcting the acts of zahir is known as fiqh and sharia, and correcting the act of batin, the hidden, that is known as tasawwuf and Sufism. That is the tariqah. So it is to balance between the two. It is to balance between the two. So when you say innamal a'malu bin niyyat, all your acts, their acceptability or rejectability depends upon your niyyah. And niyyah is a reality which is not visible, which is not physical, which does not have any physical existence. So something which does not possess any physical existence, which has no externality, the whole prayer and act of prayer and whole all world of your pious acts depend upon that particular act which is itself not visible. So correction of external acts is the subject of fiqh and sharia, and correction of internal state of mind, the niyyah and the purity of heart, is the act of tasawwuf and Sufism and tariqah. Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam combined the both. The zahir was combined with batin, and batin was combined with zahir. No beauty of zahir can be acceptable without the beauty of batin. Correction of batin is known as Sufism, and correction of zahir is known as fiqh and jurisprudence and sharia. So by combination of fiqh, sharia and tariqah, only then you can achieve the perfection of your pious acts. So Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prepared a full group of people who were named Ashabu Suffa. Ashabu Suffa, they became the torch bearers and founders of Sufism in history of Islam. And they were direct students of Holy Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And all other companions, they were not specialists in Sufism, but at the same time, occasionally they also used to practice it. So these both groups were prepared by Holy Prophet. This was a speciality, as some of them became the people of war, some of them became people of knowledge, some of them became people of law and jurisprudence, some of the companions became people of tafsir, exegesis of Quran, some of them were very, very famous in act of charity, supporting financially the whole of Ummah. So in the time of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these specialities had already started. Same was in the time of Tabi'een, followers, and the same carried on in the time of Atba'ut Tabi'een, the successors of followers. So at that time, Quran mentioned four particular duties of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Quran says, "Yatlu alaykum ayatina, wa yuzakkikum, wa yuallimukum al-kitab wal-hikmah, wa yuallimukum ma lam takunu ta'lamun." When companions used to sit in the company of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to recite the verses of Holy Quran on them. So some of the companions became specialist of reciting verses of Holy Quran, specialist in recitation of Holy Quran. So those who specialized in recitation of Holy Quran, they became huffaz and qurra. Through them, Quran, the book of Almighty Allah, was saved, protected and secured, and it was conveyed from generations to generations. Then there were some of them. Quran says, "Yatlu alaykum ayatina wa yuzakkikum." We come to the third thing. Then said, "Wa yuallimukum al-kitab wal hikmah." I will take the second matter later. So the third category was yuallimukum al-kitab. So some of the companions became scholars, became the jurists, became exegetical specialists, became authorities on Islamic law, like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, like Abdullah ibn Umar, like Abdullah ibn Abbas, like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So some of them became specialists, mujtahid, lawyers, jurists, specialists of law. So through them, the law of Islam was propagated, communicated to the Ummah. Through them, the Sharia commandments were communicated and compiled. And second word was used, يُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Holy Prophet ﷺ teaches you Kitab, the commandments of Kitab, and wisdom of Kitab. Wisdom implies logic, philosophy, reasoning, science. So some of the companions became specialist in the logic of Quranic commandments. Some of them specialist in the science of Quranic commandments, in scientific and logical interpretation of commandments. So jurisprudence emerged out of that. Logic emerged out of that. Philosophy emerged out of that. Sociology emerged out of that. Embryology emerged out of that. So all various religious and secular sciences emerged from Quran through the fountain of Al-Hikmah. All religious sciences, juridical sciences, jurisprudential sciences, and legal sciences, these sciences emerged from Quran through the fountain of يُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابِ. So recitation of Quran, of Holy Prophet's act, created qurra, the qaris. The legal interpretation of Quran created jurists and scholars and ulama in the ummah. And wisdom, hikmah, created the philosophers and scientists and interpreters and intellectuals for the Ummah, so that Islam, the deen of Islam, may be interpreted and reinterpreted and presented and reinterpreted and presented in a logical way, in a scientific way, in a methodological way, in a jurisprudential way, according to the times of the of various Ummah. Now these were two sources. Now come to the second source which I left. Yatlu alaykum ayatina wa yuzakkikum. I took first and third. Tilawatul ayah and talimul kitab wal hikmah I have taken two. Now we come to the second thing. Quran says that this is again the duty of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What? Yuzakkikum. He purifies your inner selves. He purifies your inner selves. So those companions and those followers among the Ummah of Holy Prophet, those who specialized in recitation of Quran, they became qaris and they became hafiz and Quranic reciters. Those who specialized in talimul kitab, they became the jurists and the lawyers of Islam and a'imma. Those who specialized in hikmah of Quran, they became the Muslim philosophers, they became Muslim scientists, they became the logic specialists. And those who specialized in yatlu alaykum ayatina wa yuzakkikum, and he purifies your inner selves, he purifies your inner self. So outer things are finished. Now this is a concentration on your inner part of personality. He purifies not your bodies, your nufus. Qad aflaha man zakkaha. He is the successful person who has purified his soul. So now he purifies the souls. He takes bad likings, wishes, lusts, greeds out of your soul. He purifies your inner self from the inner existence of sin, and he puts Allah's love in your soul and in your spirit, and he puts the nearness of Almighty Allah, he gives the taste of nearness of Almighty Allah to your soul and heart. So this act of purification of self, tazkiyah, qad aflaha man zakkaha wa qad khaba man dassaha, the one who has purified his inner self, he is really successful person. And the one who couldn't purify it, he may be a scholar, he may be a exegesis specialist of Quran, he may be a jurist, he may be a speaker, he may be a preacher, he may be anything, but if his batin, his soul is not purified, he is not on a right track, he is not saved, he is not successful. So that's why the second prophetic obligation was mentioned, yuzakkikum tazkiyatun nufus. So those who carried out among the companions of Holy Prophet, among their followers, among their successors, among the Ummah, those who carried out the function of self-purification because of tazkiyah and safa. Self-purification means safa'ul qalb, purification of heart, purification of soul. So because of this safa, the world tasawwuf came into existence, and those who became specialists of purification of heart and soul, they were known as Sufis. Those who became specialists in Quranic recitation, they were known as Qaris, Qurra. Those who became specialists in Quranic interpretation and Hadithic interpretation, they were known as jurists and ulama and fuqaha. Those who became specialists of hikmah, they were known as philosophers and hukama. And those who became specialists in inner purification of heart and soul, they were known as sufiya. So it means in the same way, as the ulama are successors of Holy Prophet, through the channel of yuallimukumul kitab, as the hukama, the philosopher, the scientist, are the followers of Holy Prophet, through the channel of al-hikmah, as the Hafuz and Qurra, Quranic reciters, are the followers and servants of Holy Prophet through the channel of Yatlu Alaykumul Kitab, Tilawatul Ayat. In the same way, the Sufis, the saints, the awliya and sufiya, they are true followers of Holy Prophet through the fountain of Tazkiyatun Nufus. And the fifth, يُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. When their inner self become purified, then Almighty Allah reveals His secrets unto them. Their secrets are unveiled. Then they start knowing the hidden secrets. And from Sufi, they become Arif. So Ashab al-Suffa, this was the group of Sufiya, the Sufis, among the companions of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ashab al-Suffa. And the same people, these were in the time of companions, in the time of their followers, Tabi'een. Imam Hassan Basri, a great Tabi'i, says that I met a Sufi. And you can find in every authentic book, Imam Hassan al-Basri, the great Tabi'i, who was born in the days of Sayyidina Umar, radiallahu ta'ala, 20 Hijri he was born. He says, I met a Sufi performing tawaf around the Kaaba. Imam Hassan Basri says, Ra'aytu Sufiyan yatufu bil Kaaba. He was performing tawaf of Kaaba. I saw him, I wanted to help him financially. I wanted to give him something. I took some dinars and tried to put in his hands. And he didn't accept. He said, Allah is sufficient for us. So those who have made Allah sufficient in their life, they are Sufis. And Sufis are from Safa of Qalb, purification of heart, purification of soul, purification of inner self. The last thing, a beautiful example, for example, the law and jurisprudence of Islam requires you to perform your wudu, to stand facing towards Kaaba and pray according to the commandments of Sharia. You have done everything, so according to Sharia, according to Islamic law, your prayer, your salat is complete. So I want to explain what is the link between the Sufism and the Sharia or the Fiqh. Fiqh says, Islamic law and jurisprudence says, your prayer, your salat is kamil. Tasawwuf, Sufism says, not yet. Not yet. Now you ask, why my prayer is not yet complete and perfect? Sufism says that you were facing towards Kaaba, but your heart was not facing towards Allah. So fiqh is interesting to put you straight facing towards Kaaba, and tasawwuf is interested to put your heart straight facing toward Almighty Allah, the Rabb of Kaaba. So if your bodily, this face is toward Kaaba, your salat is perfect according to fiqh. And if your heart is facing towards Rabbul Kaaba, the Lord of Kaaba, then your salat is perfect according to tasawwuf Sufism. Sufism fulfills the requirement of the purity and sincerity of your intention. Purity and sincerity of intention is never, never, never the subject of Islamic law. I am saying a very significant thing. Take up the fiqh, Kutubul fiqh, Hanafi fiqh, Shafi'i fiqh, Maliki fiqh, Hanbali fiqh, Jafari fiqh, Salafi fiqh. You may take any book of fiqh in your hands and read the chapters. They will start from tahara, ghusl, wudu, this and that. Then they'll come to the prayer, salat and som and zakat and hajj, and then all halal and haram. everything religious and secular would be mentioned there. I'm telling you a very significant point. And last, there are thousands. I have delivered 100 lectures, and every lecture, every episode of 1 hour on this subject of Sufism, 100 lectures, and every lecture is of 1 hour duration. It means 100 hours on concept of Sufism, 100 hours on this particular subject. So I am closing this subject by saying, you go to the books of fiqh, the books of Sharia, Hanafi, Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali, Jafari, Salafi, anything, they will start from purity. Purity from ghusl, from wudu, from cleanliness of your clothes, cleanliness of your body. Then they will start the matter of azan and salat, then zakat and hajj and so onwards, so far, so forth. No single book of fiqh of any school of law will discuss the matter of purity of intention. Purity of intention. No book of law will ever discuss the subject of sincerity, al-ikhlas. No book will ever, book of fiqh, will ever discuss the subject of closeness and nearness of Allah, achievement of the pleasure of Allah. All these subjects which deal with your heart, which deal with your intention, with your niyyah, purity of heart, purity of thought, purity of ideas, sincerity, nearness of Almighty Allah, love of Almighty Allah, your heart submitting to Almighty Allah, seeking for His pleasure, Rida of Allah, the pleasure of Almighty Allah, nearness of Almighty Allah. All these subjects you will never ever see in a single book of fiqh. Maybe Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali, Jafari, Salafi, any book. You will never see these subjects over there. And the question is that Holy Prophet says, innamal a'malu bin niyyat. All your acts depend upon your niyyah, your intention. If every act and acceptability of every act or rejectability of every act completely depends upon your niyyah, the hidden thing, the motive, the intention which is hidden in your heart. Are you committing the act of riya? You are doing this act to show somebody else, or you are doing this just for said prayer of Almighty Allah? This is the sole criterion on the basis of which your acts are going to be accepted or your acts are going to be rejected. But you will never ever find this particular concept of the pleasure of Allah, the niyyah of Allah, the ridwanullah, Allah's pleasure, His, or seeking Allah's pleasure, sincerity, ikhlas of niyyah. These subjects you will never see in the books of fiqh. So where will you find these subjects? These subjects have been dealt by Sufism, by tasawwuf, by spiritualism. And Holy Prophet says that all acts depend upon your niyyah, and niyyah is not subject of fiqh. Dependability of acts is based on the purity of niyyah, and purity of niyyah is not the subject of fiqh of law. This is the subject of Sufism and tasawwuf and spiritualism. So it means every act which is away from spiritualism and tasawwuf and Sufi path, that is not able to be accepted in the eyes of Almighty Allah. So zahir, connecting zahir and batin, this is the only way how you get Almighty Allah's pleasure. So Holy Prophet ﷺ prepared a full-fledged group of individuals of Ashab al-Suffa, and they were specialized of Sufism. Ashab al-Suffa, they were specialized on Sufism, on spiritualism, on spirituality, and they were always busy in cleansing their inner self and developing and promoting the abilities of their spirit and soul. So this is the basic thing which we have to deal with.